Good afternoon. Welcome to almost the last session of DrupalCon. My name is Greg Dunlap. I'm the lead for the Drupal 8 Configuration Management Commission initiative. And this session will be to tell you all about that. It's actually really heartening to see this room full of people that's interested in what's to come in Drupal 8, which, you know, we still have a while before we get to see. You know, this is a really good crowd, so I'm really glad there's so much interest in Drupal 8 and what's to come. We spent a lot of time at DrupalCon putting information together so that people can get up to speed on Drupal 8 by the time it comes out. My name is Greg. I work at Lullabot. We're a web services and website consulting company. We build sites. We do consulting. We make awesome things. We do it for some of the largest media and educational companies in the world, and it's an exciting place to work, and I really love it. We've got one of the best teams that I've ever seen in my entire life. One of the other things that we do is we run a site called Drupalize Me, which is an online training and streaming video site for Drupal. If you're interested, until May 28th, we're offering $200 off a yearly subscription to Drupalize Me. That's almost half price. It comes down to about $20 a month. These videos are created by some of the most well-educated and experienced Drupal developers in the world. In many cases, you will be educated on how to do things by the people who actually wrote them. And it's a really amazing resource if you really want to learn about Drupal and learn how to, both for coding, for site building, for setting up development, for all sorts of things. It's a really amazing resource. I encourage everybody to check it out and take advantage of that. So, on to configuration management. So, a brief history of this is that in past versions of Drupal, it's been very difficult to stage configuration from one site to another. How many people in this room have ever had this problem? So, one of the reasons that that was difficult is because in the old versions of Drupal, we kept all of the content and the configuration in the same database, sometimes in the same tables, all mushed together. So it was really difficult to separate it out and only push your configuration and not your content. And if you push all of your content, then you're going to overwrite stuff that's on your live site, including and especially for sites that have a large amount of user-generated content, like comments and forums and ratings and all of these things that make modern sites great. Another problem is that we had no centralized way to manage configuration. All of the pieces of core did it their own way, and all of the contributed modules did it their own way. Towards the middle or the beginning of the Drupal 7 cycle, some of that started coming together. CTools exports started to become more of a common thing, and features modules started to become a little more mature, but there were still a lot of problems and a lot of gaps there. And so we needed to provide a centralized and common functionality for everybody to use, for everybody to hook into, and for everybody to work with, so that we could make this really work and really be useful for the people who are building sites. And so at DrupalCon Chicago, Dries asked me to lead this initiative. I've been working in this sphere since I started using Drupal 6 years ago. It's pretty much been the only thing that I've spoken or written about since then. So I was really happy to sort of be able to run this initiative and put a cap on the work that I've been doing for a long time. I have no idea what I'm going to do with myself when it's finished. First, a word of warning. This is Drupal 8. It's still in progress. We haven't even reached API freeze or beta at this point. So any or all of the information that I'm about to present to you today could change tomorrow at the code sprint. This has been pretty stable for, you know, a good part of the last year, and we are definitely moving much more towards the user testing and bug fix mode. Some of this could change still, and so don't take it as gold. But the general concepts are pretty guaranteed to stay the same at this point. So what is configuration? Configuration is basically all of the stuff that makes your site what it is, but that isn't the stuff that your editors and your users write. So that includes things like views, image styles, your users and permissions and roles, your content types and fields. Basically, your settings, anything that isn't your site's content is configuration. These are the kinds of things that you, as a site builder or a developer, work on a day-to-day basis while your editors take those things and write content with them, and your users create content with it. So, again, in the past, this has been a big difficulty because all of that stuff has been mushed together, and so we made a common system for managing it. So what is configuration management? It's the ability to take that configuration and do some development with it, test it independently of your active production site, work through it, iterate it, and then when you're finished, deploy it to your live production site with a minimum of disruption and downtime and without disrupting any of the stuff that actually already exists there. What is CMI? CMI is, as I said before, it's the initiative for, it's the configuration management initiative, and it's what we're doing for Drupal 8 to make all of this happen and work better than it has in the past. So, let's get down to business. How does it work? So, first of all, is that configuration is now stored in files. It's been taken out of the database. The database, I think the CMI initiative has eliminated something on the order of 50 tables from Drupal. Every time one of those patches lands that removes something from hook schema, my heart soars. A lot of the tables will actually remain in Drupal because they may be needed by contrib modules for upgrade path purposes, but they won't be actively used and they'll be empty as part of the upgrade path. And then in Drupal 9, we'll actually delete them once they've been fully deprecated and moved out. So your configuration is stored in files. That means that not only is it just stored in files, the files are the canonical location for the configuration. When you make a change in the UI, it will actually write not to the database, but directly to those files as you make changes in the user interface. If you were to sit there and make a change in the UI and open the file and do a before and after, you would see that change happen right in your drive. This is what an example of what one of those files looks like. It's in a very popular machine-readable format called YAML. It's reasonably easy to write and read. As you can see, it's not horribly like reading an XML file. It's not filled with brackets and descriptors and all sorts of things. It's very straightforward, very easy to understand, nested hierarchical format. It maps to Drupal's arrays very well. So, we've been doing the configuration management initiative for a long time, and we've been moving this configuration out. And so when you install Drupal now, there's quite a few of these files. I think right now, on a default Drupal install, you get 175 configuration files. On the one hand, that's a lot of files, but on the other hand, it's really great because it means that you can stage stuff very granularly. Typically, we'll have a file per set of settings, like a settings form, and a file for each instance of a piece of configuration. Like there's a file for each view, there's a file for each field, a file for each content type, all of that sort of thing. There's a great number of these files, and they live on your drive and get written to and acted on. It's pretty cool, actually. I'm always really happy when I do a pull from Drupal 8 Core, and I see a bunch of these new files come out as the conversions get done. So you've got all these files. What do you do with them, right? So as you work, you can move the files from site to site and import them. Let's take a little look at how that works. It's interesting when I started putting this presentation together, it felt really short to me. And on one hand, I was like, well, what am I going to do to fill all that time? On the other hand, I was really happy because it meant there wasn't a lot to show about how to use this. It's really straightforward. So I hope you have lots of questions at the end. So what happens is that when your site is installed, a directory is created under your site's default files directory. In that files area where all of your public files are stored, it's named config_, and then a bunch of garbage letters. The garbage letters are required so that random people from the outside world can't surf into your configuration directory and read these files. They are, readable, and there's some potential for them to contain sensitive information like API keys and stuff like that. So we give them a randomized directory name so within that directory, there are two directories. One is called active and one is called staging. The active directory contains the configuration that is currently live on your site, the configuration that's being written as you work through and make changes, as we were just discussing. The staging directory contains configuration that's new that you want to import into your site. So when you need to make a change and deploy it, you move configuration from your source site, from your source's active directory to your destination's staging directory. You can currently move individual pieces of configuration, although we're talking about changing that, and so that's sort of up for grabs. But generally, you move configuration from your source's active directory to your destination's staging directory. You may be asking, how does that work with automated deployment and version control systems? Because usually what you want to be able to do is just sort of pull from one directory into the other and have it go live. This is a little complicated to explain, and we'll get a little techie here, but what it looks like is kind of this. You can set which directory is active and staging in your settings.php, and so your active directory on your dev site in version control is actually your staging directory on your live site, and vice versa. And so when you pull, so you make changes on your active directory on dev, you pull into your live site, and because you've swapped those in your settings.php, it's actually your staging directory on your live site. You import, and the import happens, and it goes back the reverse way, the same way. It's actually really cool. It seems a little complex at first, but because this is a more advanced use case, I didn't really mind adding the extra complexity so that the simple situations were a little easier. We had to do this two-directory system because when you have canonical files that are being written to live as you're working through it, you can't just, you know, move files from one site to another while those files are actually still live, because you've got this potential for the stuff that you're uploading getting overwritten by people actually making changes in the site as you upload. Originally, when we first developed the system, we only had one directory, and even just in testing, we started running into that problem. You know, I would move my live stuff, I would move my stuff from my dev to my live server, and then I would realize my live server was messed up in some way, and I'd go change a setting, and I'd realize I had overwritten all of the stuff that I had just uploaded. It's no good. So we had to do this two-directory system. And I think that once we sort of get the docs written, it'll be really straightforward for people to understand. So once you've gotten the files moved from one site to another, what do you do? Well, you have to go and actually import them from your, to make them go and become active. There's a administration screen in Drupal 8 that does this. If you look here, it shows the changes that are about to be imported to your site. It shows we have one new file, one changed file, and one deleted file. And, you know, depending on how much additions and deletions you'll have, you'll have different levels of things. You can actually view the differences between each file by clicking the View Differences tab. You can see here that the large image style has been changed from 480 width and height to 640 width and height. So that's a pretty simple change that you're importing. One thing about this is that you cannot do imports piecemeal or cherry pick imports. You have to import all of the configuration that you've got staged or none of it. One of the reasons for this is so that we can make sure that dependencies are handled properly. It also makes our life a little easier from the UI, and, you know, we're trying to sort of our concept with this was that we can make a basic UI that's functional for core, but we fully expect contrib to be extending and addressing more complex use cases. So you can import all of your config, you can see the differences, and away you go. You click the button, your config is imported, and that's it. That's it. It's that straightforward. I was going to do a demo today, but one of the things that we've been waiting on to land is the fields and content types, and it seems silly to do a demo without that because it's the first thing anyone does for a site. But that patch hasn't landed in time, so I didn't get to do a demo today. But it really is amazing the first time you see it run, and it's like, after all the trouble that we've all had over the years of this, to see this in place, it's really, it still blows my mind, to be honest. So some of the more advanced features of this, we've worked really, really hard to make sure that this ties into the internationalization initiative that Gabby has been running. And so there's a lot of really cool features that are coming. It's not quite sure how many of these are going to live in contributor core, but I thought I'd show them to you. Here is, for example, the site information form. Now you can see that up there it's got a tab called Translate. So you can click that tab, and it'll show you the languages that you have installed. So in this case, we've got Hungarian installed. And if you click the Edit button, it'll show you the translatable pieces of configuration that you can translate and save back new translations for. One of the interesting things to note is that there are three pieces of data on the site information form here: the site name, the slogan, and the email address. But when you go to translate, there are only two strings there to translate, because of course the email address is not translatable. It's not a translatable string. And that's one of the things that we added into the configuration system, was the ability to flag which pieces of configuration are and aren't translatable. But just because a piece of configuration is not translatable doesn't mean that you can't internationalize it. For instance, if you want to be able to have a different site email address based on the language that your site is, you can still do that. There's another system that is really kind of codey and too much to get into for this crowd, but it's a context system, and it basically allows you to contextually change configuration based on a wide variety of things, not just language, but domain name or phase of the moon or, you know, what day of the year it is and stuff like that. And so it allows you to contextually change things based on all this information. And I think we're going to see a lot of cool use cases for that. So anyways, back to this. Here are the two strings that you can translate, and you save them, and then those translations are saved. And when you use Hungarian, you'll have those translations available for you. Additionally, in places where we have listings like this, it adds a translate drop down there into the little drop down menu. So you'd be able to do it that way too. This integration is really cool. We've never had this level of integration into Core or Contrib before, because again, we've never had a centralized system that we could build around it before. We've had hacking on settings.php and Contrib modules that were very complicated and stuff like that. But we've never had this level of integration before. So what else? What's to come in the configuration management system? The configuration management system has some stuff that's still to land that we're working on that we hope will come, and I thought I'd give you a little preview of that. One of the things that's to come is that if you're used to using, for instance, views, if you're deploying views and the people, your clients on their live site have changed something behind your back, it'll give you, and this happens with features as well, it'll give you a message that has been overwritten. And that your changes may wipe out changes that have been made on that destination site. We have a patch in place to give you the same warning. It creates snapshots every time you do an import so that we can compare. And in addition to viewing the differences between your active and staging directory, which we can do now, you can also view the differences between your active and your last import so that you can see not only the differences between what you just uploaded, but also the differences between what's active. What was there the last time you uploaded and what your clients have changed on our live site. I think this is going to be really useful. There are some arguments going on around that UI and how that's all going to work and stuff like that. But I have no doubt that this is actually going to get in, and I think that people will really like it. I fought it for a long time, but many, 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 many loud voices convinced me that it should go in. Another thing that we've been talking about, especially recently, is this idea of being able to partially import your configuration. You know, the idea that all I've done is add a view, and I should be able to transfer just that view and have it be imported. This is a very natural and understandable thing to want to do, but architecturally it raises an enormous number of problems for the system. Not the least of which is dependency management, because especially in the fields and content type system, if you try to deploy an instance of a field to a content type that doesn't exist or the field definition doesn't exist, it's very difficult to make that stuff work. And in fact, in the field system, because it does a lot of messing around with database tables, it can really screw up your site badly. But on the other hand, it's also unreasonable to expect site builders to understand these dependencies, to know what file site's configuration every time you need to deploy stuff. And one of the things that we've talked about to make that easier is the ability to do one-click downloads and uploads of your entire site's configuration. This patch was written 2 days ago by Justin Randall in Australia, so we're really looking at some bleeding-edge stuff here. But basically what you would do is you would go to a page. You can see that very useful description that he has in his patch there. You would go to this page, and you would click a button, and you would download config.tar.gz and get a tarball of your configuration. And then on your remote site, you would have an upload. You choose the file, you upload it, and it automatically imports. While you would lose the ability to deploy single pieces of configuration, it would give you back the, it would still remain that you only have to deploy one thing. We would provide an API for this, so you would still be able to do this with like Drupal, with whatever other tools you want to do it. But one thing that's really nice about this is that it means that people don't have to navigate through the weird kind of let's find your strangely named config directory and make sure that we transfer to the correct directories when we move things all the time, which is something that we've been kind of concerned about being too confusing for users. And it would eliminate all of that, move it straight into the UI, abstract it away so that users don't have to worry about it if they don't want to, because those tools that I just described would all still be there in the back, and if you want to do fancy deployment or if you're contrib and you want to do other things, you still could. But this would allow a really easy-to-use and easy-to-understand way for this to happen. I think that this will probably go in, I'd say it's pretty likely. We on the team have been debating it hotly for the last few days, but I think everybody's well convinced to have a meeting with Dries to talk to him about this tomorrow. So, something to look forward to. That is largely the content of this talk right there. I wanted to talk a little bit about how the initiative worked. The initiative system has been really new this year in Drupal, and 2 years ago, actually, it was in DrupalCon Chicago when Dries asked me to lead this initiative, so that was 2011, so really almost 2.25 years ago. And one of the things that I knew was that wrangling and herding all of these cats was going to take an enormous amount of effort and time on my part. One of the things that's true of our core development is that, really of any development, is that you're not really a leader unless you provide as much to your team as they are providing, because it's very difficult for you to lead and wrangle people on 15 hours a week if they're in there coding away and posting patches 40 hours a week or 60 hours a week or 80 hours a week if you're, checks and sun, right? And so I knew I needed more time if I was going to make this work and if I was going to make it work on time. And so for the first year or so, my employer at the time, Note One, who have since moved into WonderCrowd, supplied my time. But when I left and returned to the U.S. to live, I was freelancing and having a real struggle trying to make that work. And so I did a fundraising drive, and a lot of people contributed to it. But some of these people were contributors in a very high way, and I would like to thank them right now. Andrea Dennis Publishing from the U.K., Riot Games, Pantheon, Bluehost, and WebEnable all donated $5,000 or more to the Configuration Management Initiative, allowed me to work full-time on core for 8 months. That was really amazing. How we're going to grow core and how we're going to allow people to work on it with the amount of time that they need to and fund that development is a really hot topic in the Drupal community, and I was really happy to find a way to make that successful for one use case anyways. I would also, of course, be it would be bad for me to not note that this was not the work of me. It was the work of a very large team of people. Like Drupal core development, there was a very long tail, a large number of people who have contributed patches to CMI. I actually think I only have like 20 patch commits for CMI because most of what I've done is education and wrangling and discussion and things like that. And if anything has happened on this initiative, it's only because I stood on the shoulders
source of inspiration and advice to me as I've tried to do community work. And, you know, I think I'm sure we've had at least 150 people contributed batches to CMI, and it's been a real community work. The fundraising has been a real community work, and it's been really exciting and inspiring to be a part of. And we're still working on it. If you're interested in getting involved in CORE and you never have before, there's a sprint on Friday that's being run by the CORE mentors. They're a great team of people who are very well experienced in mentoring CORE people and in getting people involved in a very approachable and simple way, making sure that people are successful early and in getting their tools and their dev environment set up and all of that. At the last DrupalCon, they had like 150 people that they got set up working on CORE at the sprint day. This year, they're expecting more. It's a really, really cool experience. If you've ever been involved in CORE development and you're interested, I highly encourage you to come to their sprint on Friday. It's really cool. Dries will do Dries and Alex and Angie's not here, but usually Angie will go on stage and make people's first patch commits, and it's really exciting and really great to see. That's like one of my favorite parts of DrupalCon, is seeing people get celebrated for making their first CORE patches. And so if you're interested in getting involved, that's happening Friday. I highly recommend it. If you're already an experienced CORE contributor and you want to get together and have some fun with a bunch of other CORE developers, the rest of the CORE initiatives, and lots of contrib projects and all sorts of interesting stuff are happening at the code print on Friday. Even if you're not really involved in CORE, you should come by. There's a lot of energy in that room, and it's really exciting to see everybody hacking away on projects for all day long. It's a really great experience. It's probably one of my favorite parts of DrupalCon. And that's all I've got. If you guys have questions, then there's a microphone at the middle of the room, and I encourage you to come and ask them.
Hi, I got a question about migrating from dev to test to prod.
Sure.
I hear I have to migrate the entire configuration for the entire site. What do I do if I have test-specific settings in test, like an Apache Solr test server?
One of the things that you can do is that the ability to override your settings using the conf array, which is the same thing that you've been able to do in Drupal 7 and versions of Drupal before, will still exist. And the ability to create environment-specific settings that way will still exist. But I also predict that very, very quickly after Drupal 8 launches, somebody will be doing a context plugin. I told you about that context system. Somebody will create a series of context plugins which allow you to read out of settings what environment you're on and modify your settings based on that context. So both of those, the one I definitely know will be existing. The other, I assume, will exist very soon after we launch. If nobody else does it, I'll probably do it. So that would be the way that you would approach that. James Sansbury.
Hi. I just wanted to say thank you so much, and for everyone, but of course, as well for you, for all the work that you've done on this, and congratulations, and I think, just especially navigating the community and everything like that, it can be some of the hardest work as well, so I just wanted to say thank you for that, but also, definitely have a lot of questions, and they all seem like they just kind of keep going, so I'll just take a couple of them and see if I can not just devolve into a spiral of crazy questions, but
okay.
So I actually had a similar question to her about the settings.php. So does that basically mean that all configuration is now a part of the conf array, or is there still that global conf variable or something that?
The global conf variable is still there. Basically the way that the system works right now is it checks to see if something exists in conf, and if it is, it uses it, period, and just blows off CMI entirely. So that global conf override ability still exists. We did add a new system as well to Drupal. I just lost my train of thought. We did add a new system to Drupal this development cycle. It's called, this is the most intuitive title ever, it's called the settings system. And and what it is it contains state information. And so state information differs from configuration in that it's environment specific. So for instance, what kind of stuff goes in there? Like the last time cron was run goes in there, for instance, because that's stuff that's specific to your environment that doesn't need to be deployed. So that system exists as well for a lot of that kind of stuff, because the variable system is actually going away too. And so you won't have the variable system to use for any of that stuff, but we needed something else, and so you've got the settings system for that kind of information.
Gotcha. Also, is the state of modules being enabled or disabled stored in configuration?
Yes, and it will be deployable, and you will be able to push that information from site to site. That actually doesn't work yet, but it will.
Cool.
And the actual files, the actual writing to the files when modules are enabled and disabled is all done, and the system table is gone, if anybody's interested in that. It's been split between configuration and state, and yes, you will be able to deploy that.
Okay. And then one final question. It sounded like the config directory is actually world readable. Is that correct? Or?
It is correct. It actually has to be, because it has to be writable by the web server. And the files directory is the only place that we have in a default install of Drupal to do that, which is why we came up with that randomized name. However, in settings.php, you can place that directory anywhere you want, including outside of WebRoot.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Let's see, myself, and I'm sure a lot of people in this room have come to rely on the features module for deployment management, and so I'm hoping you could just talk briefly on what you see the future of the features module, which I know was not originally intended for deployment, but it really, I think, has become the de facto deployment solution in Drupal, so I'm hoping you can just sort of speak a little bit about your thoughts on the future.
Yeah, sure. I've talked to the guys from Phase 2 about this before already. Basically, you know, like 75% of the code in features module is one-off code to manage the exporting and reading of configuration for parts of core that have no configuration management. So the first thing that they'll be able to do is basically throw away like three-quarters of their code, which everybody's always happy to be able to do. And then I think what's going to happen is that features is just going to become an advanced UI on top of CMI. And they'll be able to focus on that and the packaging part of it, rather than having to spend all this time managing, you know, how do we deploy deletes and how do we manage fields and how do we manage user permissions and how do we manage all of this other stuff. And they're actually really happy about that. I should point out that when I say earlier, I said that you would have to deploy all of your files at once. There will be ways to, depending on how you're set up, to partially deploy config. For instance, if your staging directory on your remote site already has a full set of config, then you only need to deploy the stuff that's changed. But I didn't want to get too much into that. But however, features will still be able to, I believe, package up and deploy the kind of things that they already do. Because they write modules, they'll be able to add on a bunch of additional functionality on top of CMI that we don't, if they choose to continue to work that way. So I fully believe that their feature set will continue to be fully supported if they like to.
That actually answers my question. Thanks.
Great. I think I just saw like three people get out of line, so that's great.
I'm sorry, didn't answer mine. So I'm assuming that when people write modules, that they're going to have configuration as part of the module install, and obviously get rid of it when you uninstall a module. With that being said, then, for example, using Views, Views would know about its own dependencies. So why not be able to just deploy Vue? Because you wouldn't get into that kind of a situation with you, maybe with custom modules you might, but with something like Views, I would think that you would be able to do that without
few scenarios in which that becomes problematic. One is deploying deletion of configuration. How do you deploy the fact that something is gone? In the original system, we specified that if a piece of configuration was missing, that meant that it was deleted. But if you're not deploying your entire configuration tree, then what is and isn't missing is an unknown quantity. In the system as it exists now, I created the concept of manifests in addition to individual pieces of configuration, which are a list of all of the configuration. But in that scenario, you still can't deploy one file and do an add or delete. You have to deploy the file and the manifest file. So that's one problem. Another problem is that Views knows about its own dependencies, but it doesn't know a lot about the plugins that feed into those views. So it's very easy to deploy a view that relies on a plugin that you haven't distributed, for instance, and then that view won't work. We've all probably seen that case where we're using Views and it says broken or missing handler, and that's the exact problem that we're talking about here. And that being said, while the use cases for many parts of core are simpler, the dependency management in the fields and content type system is extremely complicated. And I was very reluctant to design a system where I had to say to people, you can deploy piecemeal files 90% of the time, but in this other 10%, if you do it, your whole site will explode. You know? Okay, I'll buy it. And so a lot of these functionalities, you know, off the record will still exist. A lot of them will still work if you know what you're doing. But I am not going to come out and say to you, you can do this. This will always work because there is a wide variety of cases where they won't. Many of them are very common, and who knows what contrib's going to do, right? So that's sort of the thinking behind that.
Okay, and my other question is, have you given thought to being able to roll back configurations?
We have, and it's a similar problem. There's a lot of stuff in Drupal that can't be rolled back. Field changes cannot be rolled back because they rely on changing data table structures and the data within them. And so it was a very similar situation very early in CMI. One of the things that we talked about was the ability to provide nested undos of configuration in the UI. And you can just click, 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 and undo. But the problem is that because field changes can't be undone, we would end up in a situation where in some cases the undo would work and in some cases it wouldn't. And I think that would be more confusing to people than providing it in the first place. I wouldn't be surprised if some contrib module wants to provide it, then it's their problem, not mine. But
so it's going to be my problem, is what you're saying.
Yeah, exactly. So configuration can be rolled. So it's a similar situation. In 90% of the cases, configuration can be easily rolled back. But there are some things that Drupal Core won't allow rolling back, and I can't do anything about that. So.
So how does CMI do deletes? Does it do what you suggested a couple of questions ago?
No, actually, if this patch that requires the presence of the full tree in order to import lands, then it will go back to doing deletes by simply indicating the lack of a file means that it should be deleted. But right now, it's using the manifest, the listing thing that I had told you about when he asked about it.
Okay. So that's state of flux.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
The setting system that stores things like when cron was last run, is that similar to the variables table like a key value pattern?
Yes, that's pretty much exactly what it is. It lives in the database by default. It's got pluggable storage. Almost everything in Drupal has pluggable storage at this point. Even CMI has pluggable storage, so if you want to put your configuration in, I don't know, in memcache or in DevNull, you totally can. I hear that putting your configuration in DevNull is totally web scale, so.
that config directory, does the secret path, does that change, or is that set once when the site is installed?
It's different per installation. So if you do anyone who does an installation gets a different random key, it's based on the random salt that Drupal generates when you do an installation. So if you do an installation on two sites, the key will be different unless you also deploy the same salt to two sites, or you do what's more common, which is that you simply back up your entire file system, move it, and the database dump would
if that's set once per installation, if that gets leaked, then all the settings can be accessed via the web, or is it protected by HT access?
It is protected by HT access. But even though it's the same on both places, it's still randomized to begin with. I think that as a security measure, we're going to recommend as best practice that that be located outside of your web root, or that you give it a name that's completely different from what we generate, so that it's even harder to guess. That string is a 32-character randomized case-sensitive string, so guessing it is going to be very difficult. But there are situations where it's very easy to forget to deploy your HT access. I know that the most common one is that if you do it this via an add star, it doesn't pick up dot files, and I've more than once deployed sites without a default HT access, and that was one of the reasons that we felt that we needed additional security. Not to mention the fact that, you know, not all web servers manage HT access properly, and et cetera, et cetera.
So can you then change the name of that directory after the fact?
Yeah, you can change it to whatever you want to, and it's managed in settings.php.
Okay. If the private file system is enabled, does it put it there by default, which is automatically more secure?
No, we've talked about that, and for the moment, we're not doing that.
Okay. You can say it's still complicated.
I have to go back. The issue was like 3 months ago, and I don't have a quick answer for you right
That's
now.
I'm sorry. Okay. My last one is more of a request. I don't know if you want to do it or not, but I'd be really keen to see in a bit more detail how deploying works with Git with the system. The fact that it's in the files directory would mean it's not version control, but with most Git workflows.
Yeah, I actually met with a couple of people who are really interested in helping to write the technical documentation for this. They're experienced technical writers, and I've been trying to be really focused on getting together a group of people to write the documentation who are experienced, who know how to write this kind of documentation well, as opposed to me, because I really don't. We plan on providing a full set of documentation to be available for on Drupal.org for this. I've also been pondering writing a book, so that might happen too, about configuration management in Drupal. I kind of hate myself for thinking of it, though, but it might happen.
For Drupal multi-site, is it going to be a different configuration per site? Or is there going to be a possibility of a shared configuration between all sites? And if there was a shared configuration, would there be the possibility of doing just specific overrides per site?
I'm trying to remember how multi-site works. Because if I remember correctly, you've got default, all, and the site-specific files, and they all have their own file directories, right? So by that measure, it would work with the same hierarchy that it does now. Anything that's in all would take preference over anything that's in the, no, anything that's in the individual directories would take precedence over anything that's in all, unless the individual directories didn't exist and then all would run. It should run. I haven't specifically tested this, although I know we did run through it at one point, but it should work under the same concepts that the existing multi-site functionality works.
Just to clarify for myself, if just say you have in sites all, you have your configuration directory, and that gets shared across all your multi-sites, would there be the possibility of having just like one YAML file for a specific site you needed to just override, like a view or something like that?
There should be. I mean, yeah, I'd rather have something nicer than that. But on the other hand, you know, the assumption of this system as it stands now is that the full set of config that exists there is what's canonical. And we've talked about something similar, which is that, for instance, there's a big problem doing things like I've got a view that I'm using on 10 multi-sites, and in one of them, they want to have 10 things in the slideshow instead of 5. So you override the view, and now you've got two views, right? settings for the master view cascaded down to the difference view, even though it had its own little tweaks to it. Right? We don't have anything specific to manage that at this point. It was one of those things that we talked about, and we just never got around to. Again, I wouldn't be surprised to see contributors starting to offer more complicated and advanced solutions for that, but it's not anything that we've really addressed specifically.
Thank you.
Yep.
So this probably exposes some of my lack of knowledge about Drupal 8, but in 7, there are a number of things, like menu links, things that are kind of arguably a configuration in some cases, or maybe content in others. Maybe you can talk a little bit to how you are seeing this shakedown in Drupal 8, and where do you see these kind of like edge cases?
My general rule in Drupal 8 has been that anything that's not an entity is configuration. That said, a lot of things in Drupal 8 have become entities. So, for instance, menu links, the one that you create through the admin, are entities now. I believe that taxonomy terms are entities, but vocabularies are configuration. A lot of other things, path aliasing is something that we've had a real problem with. Path aliasing is really tough to define because by my rights, any path alias that directs to a specific node, which is like 98% of what path aliases are, is content that doesn't belong in configuration. It's anything that has a one-to-one relationship to a node, be it a path alias or a panels override or whatever it is content. It only applies to that node. But on the other hand, the other 5% of it is really tricky because there's a lot of stuff that goes into path alias that doesn't go to nodes. They go to views, they go to the login page and stuff like that. And I admit we don't have a good answer for that one situation right now. We're still kind of trying to work that out. Another situation that I know we had problems with was the IP blacklist. I think we're just going to end up leaving that in the database table. If we consider that state, it's really environment specific what their IP blacklist is. And there's not really a big use case for making that deployable. But in general, you know, this question of what's configuration and what's content has been something that we've struggled with a lot. And the general answer will be, you know, anything that's not an entity is configuration.
In Drupal 7, for features, you could package views into little modules. So since views is going to be configuration, it seems logical that you could still package those views into modules that are installed across all the sites in a multi-site. Is there any... So then, as far as the cascade goes, you were able to override in features on a per-site basis those settings, like an individual setting, like the slideshow one that you mentioned. And there's absolutely nothing in core that would allow for that. Is there something that you mentioned filling this need, but there is something built in that Contrib could tie into?
Well, yeah, I mean, I talked about this context system, and so in a multi-site, which site you're on would be a context that Contrib can key off of. And that was one of the reasons when we first talked about this, the context system came around based on our discussions about multilingual functionality, and I was really wanting to simply write a multilingual system and be done with it, because one of my key priorities for the system, which I've failed somewhat miserably at, was to keep it extremely simple. But you know, core supports a lot of use cases, and you know, I mean, when you try to be something for everybody, you have to do a lot to support that, and so. The context system came out of that because we kept coming up with use cases that were contextual and we didn't want to keep writing one-off systems for, and it allowed us to punt on a lot of hard questions, to be honest. And so I would, you know, the context system will allow somebody to do all sorts of things based on domain name if they want to, if Contrib was written it or somebody wants to write a module to do it, and I can sort of say that's not my problem, which is nice. I mean, these are tough questions, and we only have so much time to get stuff done for core. So.
Just one quick. I was wondering about validation of some of the variables that we have in validations.
One of the things that happens is at the time that you import, if your file is invalid YAML, it can't be imported, and the entire import stops. We have. It's not added yet, but it's going to happen, a validation step. The process of what happens in what order in the configuration import is extremely complicated. So, for instance, you always need to enable modules before you do anything else because they can depend on them. Then, when it comes to validation, you need to validate everything before you even start importing because there are various things that can go wrong in the middle of an import, and leaving your import half done is a complete disaster. So it's like we have to do all of the validation, then we have to do all of the modules, and then we have to do the import in the correct order so that the dependencies in the import are done. So we've been talking a lot about how to get this validation done and make sure it's done right so that it's not messed up. But basically what we're going to be providing is a validation hook so that modules can go out and say, I want to look at my configuration and make sure that it's okay. But it's the individual module's responsibility to do that, aside for stuff that's really global, like, for instance, is your YAML valid and stuff like that. So.
Hi, a comment and a question. The comment first is about the earlier question about SVN and Git. I guess I want to say that, you know, first of all, thanks a lot for getting to this point, because we constantly have this problem of trying to understand what the development path was for a particular site, what got changed when. And obviously, the more of this is in some kind of text format that we can pour into Git and port back out and see the timestamps for changes, this is just huge. So the part of that, when you were talking about context and configuration, my take on it is that anything that would define that path really ought to be thought of as configuration. And so again, we can do whatever it takes to get it into Git, and then use Git to tell us what got changed when. That's the comment. But thanks for getting to this point. The question's about performance. And I'm kind of curious, if you see this way of pulling configuration performance neutral as opposed to having it in the database and being able to do query caching and stuff like that?
It's definitely not performance neutral. There's no doubt that we've taken a performance hit by implementing this system. There is caching in front of it. The caching is pluggable just like everything else. So mostly we're going to the database instead of files on a read basis generally. But on the other hand, that means that even on cache pages, we're having to go to the database 5 or 6 times just to get through Bootstrap. So that's a problem that we've been discussing and don't have a lot of excellent answers to. It may be something you just have to live with. We've talked about caching groups of configuration based on the path, similar to the way that they do JavaScript and CSS aggregation. This would allow us to get all of the configuration for a path in one query instead of 6. But, I mean, there's no doubt that it's not performance neutral, and we're just trying to do what we can to reduce the impact as much as possible. Abstraction and abstraction always costs in performance. It's just the way life is. Abstraction and flexibility always pay performance. I will also point out that performance isn't necessarily a simple measure. While page load times are negatively impacted, the memory footprint of Drupal will be very positively impacted by this. One of the things that happens on every Drupal site is that when the Drupal site gets loaded, the entirety of the variables table gets loaded into PHP's memory. And in many, many sites, especially if you have a lot of modules installed, that's easily on the order of 5,000 database rows. So by being able to granularly load only the configuration that we need, we're actually having a very positive impact on the memory footprint. So a lot of this stuff is just trade-offs.
I think what you just said was that you don't want to give some kind of a number at this point, just that you feel like there's a hit.
You're correct, and we're still in development, and so it would be inappropriate for me to make any definitive comment on performance, other than to say there's no doubt I think that Drupal 8 will be some percentage slower than Drupal 7 out of the box. But then again, out of the box is not a comparison to Drupal 7. We didn't have views, we didn't have blah, 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 so it's all, you know, it's really hard to judge.
Thanks.
Just a quick question. I guess going back to the multi-site facet of it, I wasn't sure. It sounded like you were a bit hesitant about the context part of the controlling here of all the different files and things like that. We were saying about the cascading. How mature is the context system? And you were saying how can it really be applied to the multi-sites? If you guys even really had a chance to talk about it.
The context system is pretty mature. if there's a reason why I'm hesitant to make definitive comments on it, it's because it was largely written as a part of the multilingual initiative, and I'm not enormously familiar with the code and its code paths. However, I do know it was written by Jose Riero and Gabriel Hotze, who are the easily the most experienced and the most most like wide range of experience in doing this kind of work. And they're very familiar with the use cases of other common contextual systems, like, for instance, domain access, which is one of the, and Ken Rickard has vetted this system and said that it's okay. So if I'm hesitant, it's only because I personally can't see that code path in my head. But these are exactly the kind of use cases that we designed the context system to be around. So that's exactly what the kind of stuff that I would expect it to be used for. It looks like that's it. So thanks a lot for coming. Enjoy the rest of your day.